Richard Skipper celebrates. Every show is a celebration. Each show, Richard delivers the artists you love, showcasing what makes them unique. Never gossipy. The antidote to a sometimes hectic world. Now, here's your host, Richard Skipper.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very special edition of Richard Skipper Celebrates. We are still in the midst of a pandemic, but creativity continues to flow. I'm so thrilled that all of you are taking the time to spend with me and Melissa Manchester this afternoon, or I should say Melissa Manchester and I. She's the focal person here. But I'm always about celebrating a person's body of worth and what they bring to the table. And Melissa Manchester is always worth celebrating. I've been one of the fortunate ones. I've interviewed her several times. I've interviewed her for my blog. I've interviewed her for a live broadcast from Sardis. And I've interviewed her just for general shows that she's doing. I was scheduled to see Melissa on May 3rd at Queensborough Community College here in New York. And unfortunately, that did not happen. But today, we get an opportunity to sit one-on-one with the one and only Melissa Manchester. Before I bring Melissa on, I'd like to share something with you that she just created, and it shows a whole different realm of her creativity. Sit back and enjoy, and afterwards, meet Melissa Manchester.
Thank you.
Wow, is that timely. How are you,
I'm
Melissa?
Very well.
I mean,
thank you so much for inviting me here, and thank you so much for playing Awake. I really appreciate that.
Well, it's an amazing piece, and it's very important now more than ever. I hope that everybody who was watching was singing along. The lyrics were there. Yes. I want to ask you, how are you really in the midst of what we're going through right now?
Well, I'm okay, but it's more complicated that because I'm experiencing this period of time, like so many, going through so many layers of experience because we got slammed shut. I had just come back from a jazz festival in Jakarta, and the next week, I guess I went into semi-retirement. And the first thing I had to
experience, based on what I'm seeing, you certainly haven't.
Well, I've been, you know, keeping myself busy, but you know, you're peeking over a whole other life experience. And I have experienced grief for my former life because being home usually designated that I was between gigs, and now I'm home for a while, and I love being home. My daughter's moved in with me, and it's fine. It's lovely, but it's odd. I've had to experience grief and anxiety for what the future may look like, and all of it, and really, really notice the comings and goings of my mind, which I have told other people I consider as a beloved pet. It's always sniffing around for ideas and trying to navigate through life as it presents itself. So these are very peculiar times. It's although the gift for me of this moment that we are all in is to, because we are forced to pause and not just be quiet, but be still, we have to look at what is broken in our society and what has never been attended to in our society. And for me, I feel the component of what white privilege means more than ever before, the depth and breadth and width and height of things that I take for granted that not all of my fellow citizens do, and what that means now and how it impacts me and everybody else. So it's a deeply interesting time.
There's a lot to unravel there.
Yes.
I want to start with the word pause, because for me, that's what this time is all about as well. Yesterday, I had the good fortune to interview another mutual friend of ours, David Joseph, who sends his love, by the way. And we were talking about, you know, the fact that right now, just the things that we took for granted before. So many people take for granted that when Melissa Manchester's name appears in the newspaper, for example, that they're going to be able to buy their tickets, and they're going to be able to show up, and they're going to be there, and you're going to come on, and you're going to be as brilliant as you always are. But we take those things for granted. And I think right now, Ken Davenport, I don't know if you're familiar with him, but he writes an incredible blog. And the hashtag that he uses is hashtag stronger is longer is stronger, because we need to take this time to pause and not rush things to get back. I also love the fact that you mentioned white privilege, and it's something that I too have been thinking about, and something that I grew up in the South, and I know that you grew up in the Bronx, but and our lives couldn't be any more different, but we both have experienced what it is like to go through life with white privilege.
Yes, the component of things we took for granted, just walking out of the house, not looking to the right or to the left, driving a car, not thinking about the police who was pulling up behind us because probably a taillight was broken, whatever. None of those things. And because it's in, I forget how you use that word relief, how it's in relief now, reframed, because we can't go anywhere. We have to look at what the murder of George Floyd looks like and how it resonates for the brokenness of a system that needs to be repaired. I think we're really going off on a tangent now, but yeah. I think the word defund the police, mm-hmm. it's the wrong word. I think it was co-opted too early and too quickly for people who are just looking for something to hang on to and a slogan-ish kind of a thing. It's not that. It's rethinking how to police. And, and we're in such bizarre times, complicated by the occupant in the Oval Office who is now talking of all members of armed forces as losers and suckers. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful my father is not alive. It's just a deeply interesting time. I'm doing what I can. I keep showing up on Seth Rudetsky's campaigns, either for the Actors Fund.
I've been watching them, and I love Seth. So thank him and the Actors Seth Fund and for
James,
what doing.
Yeah, Seth and James are true patriots. They have. First of all, for the Actors Fund, they are nearing $500,000 that they have raised. And for the different candidates across the nation, mm-hmm. we've been doing these brief little showings. And that's what I can do. So that's what I do. And they asked me the last time, because I've done so many of them, I started with their concerts across America, Concerts mm-hmm. for America, which they started right after the occupant was voted in. And they said, why do you keep doing these? I said, well, because you keep asking. And the other thing is because I was raised by my mother in particular. She was a Roosevelt Democrat and she marched. Mm-hmm. And so short of marching, we have Zoom, which is pretty remarkable.
Well, one of the wonderful things that I love about you, Melissa, among many others, is the fact that you do show up. And that you have always been there. And when your name is called, you show up. And that's really an incredible thing that you do. One thing that I'm reminded of more than ever at this time is that no man is an island. And that we are all, I love what my dear friend David Friedman says. And I quote him all the time, practically every episode. People are going to get tired of this. But one of the things he says is that we're all in this together, but we're not in the same boat. We all have to take that moment and think. I'm doing a course now based on a book called Positive Intelligence. And one of the things that it tells us to do is when we look at someone, imagine that person as a five-year-old without any of the things that they've been encumbered with as they grow older. And it's important that we look into the eyes and the souls of the people that are out there. This interview is getting deep, but as a great artist, that it's not done alone. It's all done with collaboration. It takes a village with every project that comes to fruition.
It does. I mean, what is extraordinary in these times is I always thought that the entertainment field was depression proof. It is not, however, pandemic proof.
Yes.
And that and the suffering of every strata of our industry is really heartbreaking. And waiting for protocol to get us back mm-hmm. into our place, even if it creates a new normal, we're waiting. I think the game changer obviously will be the vaccine. Mm-hmm. But the mishandling of it.
That's another whole interview.
I mean, honestly, my late puppy could have done better, I do believe.
That's what I keep saying, but I want to go back. For me, the moment that the clocks all stopped was March 12th. That's when all the theaters in New York City shut down and all of a sudden concerts across the country shut down. I have friends who are watching today. I was visiting them in the Hamptons, around this time last year. Yes. And they said, Melissa Manchester is going to be appearing at Queensborough College. And we went on and we got the tickets then. And Susan Agin, God bless her, I love her dearly. She reached out and she said, I can give you a refund. I said, hold the money. You may need it, hold it, and this is going to happen. What was your calendar like on March 12th? when everything shut down?
Oh, I had just had a gig on March 8th that I had to unfortunately cancel, the second time in my career that I've canceled due to illness. I came back from Jakarta and I got a little sick and I thought, do I have COVID? It doesn't line up with any of the symptoms, and it turned out not to be. But I had things to do through the end of the year. Plus, I was in the middle of finishing an album. And, you know, suddenly you couldn't get into the studio, and it was weird. And so most of the concerts have been rescheduled for 2021, but oh, who knows? Plus, I have a musical that I composed, Sweet Potato Queens, that's supposed to be getting two productions this coming year. But who knows?
That is one musical I'm waiting for because I love the book so much.
Yes, exactly.
Can you tell those who don't know a little bit about Sweet Potato Queens?
Well, Sweet Potato Queens is based on a collection of books written by Jill Connor Brown, a fabulous woman, very, very much alive, who lives in Jackson, Mississippi. And luckily, last year we got a chance to get the production in Jackson, Mississippi. So it was fantastic. And Jill Connor Brown was living, though she was the first aerobics teacher in Jackson, and she wrote a humor column in the local alternative newspaper. Her life with her baby and a deadbeat husband was really going nowhere fast, as was the lives of all of her friends in Jackson, really bright and talented women that just were all sort of black sheep in that area. And so Jill was lolling in her bathtub one day and dreamt her way out of this despair. And her version of the solution was to go into a pawn shop. And though she was a willowy 6-foot woman, she got herself a green chiffon cocktail dress, size 24, stuffed the boobs because she knew the white men would like that, stuffed the booty because she knew the black men would like that. And she said, yeah, there were about 15 good teddy bears stuffed into that dress. Got a great big red wig, a tiara, some smashing sunglasses, and rented a flatbed truck for all of her girlfriends who would be dressed the same way at the end of the 1980 St. Patrick's Day parade without telling the Chamber of Commerce that they would be the last float, where they were actually throwing real sweet potatoes at the blockers who weren't quite sure what was going on, and they were certainly waving. And at the end of her first book, the Sweet Potato Queen's Book of Love, she said, so if you're not doing anything next St. Patrick's Day, do come down to Jackson, Mississippi. We'll be waiting for you. You can dress up your own version of what a queen looks like. And thousands and thousands of people, so many thousands of people showed up that they had to build a Hilton hotel just to take care of them. And so all of the books have been New York Times bestsellers. And every time we do a production, we first did a production in 2017 at Tuts in Houston. The audience is, straight or gay, they're all in drag. And my favorite response are the husbands who are brought in, who have no idea what's ahead of them, and they scream and cheer and laugh with all the women. It's just fabulous.
I'm always fascinated by the inspiration, that light bulb that goes off over an artist's head that draws you to a project. Did you read this book prior? Did someone bring this idea to you? How did that come about?
No. I was minding my own business, reading my Sunday Times years ago, and this was in what was called the View section of the Los Angeles Times. It was a full half page with a picture of some kind of cockamamie float with cockamamie women in these enormous wigs and doing this, to throngs. And I was reading this interview with Jill Brown, and her language was so musical. I said to myself, this is a musical. This is it, because this language sings. And I had just started writing with Sharon Vaughn, who is a member of the Songwriters Hall of Fame in Nashville, and an enormously successful songwriter in her own right. And she had told me that she wanted to work to work in the world of musical theater. And I brought this to her, and it was just fabulous, because she is a Southern woman, and you know, you don't want to, I mean, I'm the ringer in the bunch, but you don't want to
I know them all.
Fake, right. You don't want to fake that style. What was interesting about Jill is she just loves, she's moved by an array of music, you know, Motown, Delbert McClinton, all kinds of people. And then we brought in Rupert Holmes to write the book. So that was,
wow. We were on really a neighbor of mine.
Steady ground. Oh, interesting. Yeah. Steady ground. Yeah.
And has this been an easy process for you, or has it been, obviously with what we're going through right now, let's take that out of the mix. Has this been just, has it unfolded the way that you envisioned it?
No, I mean, no, because, you know, there's God's time and then there's my time. And I've learned to trust God's time. Because as you know, when you're trying to develop something, it takes years longer than you think it will. You know, in my mind, it'll be done by next Thursday. Are you busy? You know, years and years later. But it had to do with many factors. Rupert was very busy with other projects all the time, so it was hard to get him to focus. And then when he did, it was fantastic. And I was on the road. And then Sharon was busy with other projects. So it took time, and but you know, it ended up perfect timing.
But this has been done on the boards. Who was in the cast originally?
Susan Coonan was in the cast. She was the lead originally when we did it at Tuts, and Carissa Arrington, brilliant, and Christina Stroop and Kevin Cooney are just a few of the actors. They're all, you know, really spectacular. And so it was fun.
Well, I wish you lots of success with that. Now, one of the things that a lot of people may not know about you is that you also teach. And I'd like to talk a little bit about that. Let's, before we get to your teaching, who were some of your teachers or mentors growing up who really made a major impact on the trajectory of your life and career?
When I was 17, I was fortunate enough to study with Paul Simon, the great Paul Simon, at NYU School of the Arts, which I had left the year before after a year of studying. I studied with the great Olympia Dukakis, but I realized that I was not, she was magnificent, but I realized that that was not my path. And I was already a jingle singer. You know, I was already friends with Manilow and Patty Austin and Ashford and Simpson. Those are my pals that I sang with all the time. But Paul Simon's class was astounding in that he auditioned everybody who wanted to try to get into his class. And when it came time for my audition, I was a major Laura Nyro fan. She was my muse, actually. And so I played my first song for him, and he said, play another. So I played a second song for him, and he said, play one more song, would you? And I played one more song, and he said, do you listen to Laura Nyro? I said, all the time, day and night, first thing in the morning, last thing at night. He said, okay, it's time to stop now. And I got into the class, and it was very interesting. It was a very disparate group of young people in the class. It was simply run. It ran for about 6 months, 2 hours once a week. We each had to come into the class with an idea for a song, including him. And context being everything, Bridge Over Troubled Waters was number one all over the world at that time. So we really got a chance to see his process, which was enormously scholarly. And deeply interesting. For instance, he said, as far as Bridge Over Troubled Waters, he said, you know that bridge, Sail on Silver Girl? And we all said, yeah. And he said, well, it really had nothing to do with the song. I just had a girlfriend who was prematurely gray, and I just liked the idea. But he, you know, he studied, he's so scholarly, everything he studies. The songs come out of enormous investment in study. So he was just, he was great. He would bring in interesting people to be part of the class. One night, Isaac Stern came in. One night, Al Cooper came in. I mean, you just never knew. And some people did their best work there. My friend who signed me up for the course was a lovely playwright, Jeffrey Sweet. And we wrote, I sent him my love. Yes. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. It's great. And then another teacher who was just fantastic along the way, besides Olympia Dukakis, was Nina Foch. Nina was, she was a starlet in Hollywood in the 40s.
An American in Paris.
American in Paris, exactly.
PCM just did a whole day of her films.
Oh, interesting. That's right. That's exactly right. And she was recommended to me by Barry Manilow, who had been studying with her. And you know, the thing is that Manilow and I, we were just so hungry to do, in my case, what I'd been doing in my mother's living room all of those years. Everybody sang. And when there was company over, we all sang. It's just what we did. And so to actually start to do this on a stage, frequently in a very smoke-filled room, sometimes with my back to the audience, because I would play on any upright piano that a college coffee house would offer me. And so to start to learn about the craft of performance, you know, Nina gave me focus and how to use space on a stage, because it's, you know, stage is so, it's such a holy place, you know, and to offer that to the audience, of course, they don't know that they're offering you their performance, but nonetheless, it is a communal exchange. And so those are some of the teachers,
And I want to go back, we'll get to your teaching in a moment, but I want to go back to the jingles. When and how did that start for you? And when was the first time that you heard one of your jingles actually played for the first time?
Well, I started singing jingles when I was 15. My late brother-in-law got me, he knew that I sang, and he brought me up to the jingle house where he was working, and I started to sing. I started to sing Camaro, you know, for the Camaro card, car, and Morton Salt, and then a lot of stuff with Manilow. And the first time I heard it, I was still in New York, and you know, it was just incredible. It's incredible. You know, mostly I wasn't a solo. Mostly I was part of a group, which was a great source of learning. Because you have to learn how to blend, you have to listen to what the contractor, the man who hires you, and what they are trying to get for their client. And frequently they didn't know how to express themselves. So, you know, you would just sort of, does that mean louder or softer? Could you be a little more specific? No? Okay, we'll take care of this. And, you know, and on you go. So you just learn to think on your feet really fast, because in the studio, you know, time is money, and you do that. So, yeah, it's great.
And I want to jump ahead a few moments. Where were you the first time that you heard one of your songs on the radio?
I was driving through Texas. I was with my first road manager, and we were, you know, what you would do is, you probably still do it, that part probably doesn't change, but you know, you would write an album, you would record an album, and then you'd work really hard to tour and do radio, you know, get it on radio, either primary radio stations or secondary or college radio stations, very important. And we were driving through Texas, and the whole thing in those days, this is for Midnight Blue, and this was before radio became programmed across the nation from one or two programming sources. So there were still independent DJs in my major markets. And so the first time I heard Midnight Blue, it was a game changer for me. You know, I mean, I'd heard myself in jingles and stuff like that, but to actually hear my own composition and knowing what it was like in the studio and who was playing and that I was singing and the background part, it was remarkable, only to be followed by the equally, if not more remarkable, recognition at their next concert when I started playing the intro and the audience just erupted. And I knew that there was a seismic shift that had happened.
Now, you and I have talked about this before, but I'd like to revisit it with you. Sure. The music industry has changed so much since you first got into it. What are the things that you love most about the changes in the way that things are done now? And what are things that you really miss that were in place when you first started out?
Well, you know, though the landscape of the music industry that I entered into doesn't really exist anymore. You could actually, for instance, make a living on publishing advances or recording advances, because those components were the banks. Mm-hmm. There are very few publishing advances that anybody is getting these days. And with Spotify and all of the streams, it's much harder to get paid and to be paid something that is equivalent to a living, really.
Now, I don't know if you saw this, but yesterday I saw an article that Facebook is really cracking down starting October 1st on live streaming across the boards.
Oh,
so all the entertainers that are watching, please be aware of all of the changes that are taking place. Are you familiar, or do you know about some of the changes that are taking place?
I'm not quite familiar with that. What I was familiar with, the contracts that were signed. I mean, you know, this is again, context being everything. It's just fascinating. Mm-hmm. For those of us who signed contracts in the 60s, 70s, or even early 80s, those contracts were in concrete because there was no imagining of the different revenue streams that exist now.
Mm-hmm.
And also in those days, managers, it didn't occur to them to ask for parts of your publishing as incentivizing, mm-hmm. which makes me nervous. But it's that. The good thing is, however, about the different platforms is they exist. They allow people to present their work regardless of what level of expertise it is in, whatever state mm-hmm. it's in. I mean, you know, you can turn on your camera and hold a flashbulb under your chin and get a million hits, and suddenly you're a big star.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the bottom line is, how do you do once you start touring, and what does it look like on stage? You know, I think the thing that is true and that does not change is, and that has come full circle, is that most performers in this day and age, because of the changes in payment per song and all that, because of the streams, mm-hmm. is you make your living basically on the road, and that part has never changed. Mm-hmm. It's fascinating. You know, it is literally the reinvention of the wheel, but it is not quite round the way we knew round, you know.
Now, getting back to where I started with all this, the teaching, how did that come about, and what do you get out of being a teacher? I mean, you're an incredible entertainer, but what do you get back from your students?
You know, I was invited to teach. I was taking over a class for Jason Robert Brown at USC, and it was a fascinating class. It was called Musical Theater Writing for Pop Students, Pop Music Students. And so the overall project, the semester project, I had 15 classes. I had 8 or 9 kids. Mm-hmm. They were all pop students, guitarists, pianists, singers. And the project was, by the end of the 15th class, to create a musical. And to watch a pop kid shift and become a musical theater character-driven songwriter was fascinating. And the way I did that was I introduced myself, and I brought in all of the PBS Tony outtakes, so they could see these Tony performances, and I would explain to them what a character song was, an expository song was, a plot song was, and I said, why is this working? And little by little, they started to understand this is working thus and such. And it was my daughter's idea to do Breakfast Club, the film, as a musical. And we watched it. We had the perfect amount of students to take on each character. They followed the trajectory of each character. And that was how that started. And then they kept inviting me back. And what I teach is what I know.
Mm-hmm.
What I teach are my experiences, because I remember without a shadow of a doubt of what it's like to be 17 and starting. I remember that as if it was yesterday, because it is sort of yesterday. Time mm-hmm. is fluid. I've been doing this almost 50 years. They can't imagine 50 minutes from now.
That's and true. So,
yes. And so I teach them about strategies. And if they're talking about songwriting and they bring in their songs, we discuss rhyme schemes. We discuss supporting your title, if that's what your point is. It's about explaining to them that they have to understand that they are not writing for their people that love them. They're writing for people who have never heard of them, who will pass them by after 3 minutes and 30 seconds. And so the clarity of the lyric has to really move the story forward as quickly as possible. And yeah, also be unique as possible.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
And because that's what Paul Simon really taught me, and that's what I move forward. Pardon me.
He said
that all of the stories have been told. It's the way you tell the story that's your mark of authenticity.
That's amazing. That's real. And it's true. It's absolutely true. Have you embraced this new virtual world that we're living in? Are you still struggling with it?
Well, I need my daughter to tell me how to do things. I'm grateful that we can chat like this. It's a miracle. Mm-hmm. Do I feel compelled to do a concert a week like many of my colleagues? No. Because I'm doing other things. Mm-hmm. But I think when we look back on this time, and my prayer is that every day we get closer to a vaccine and we get closer mm-hmm. to this veil being lifted. Mm-hmm. I think that when we have gotten to the other side of this, I personally will keep talking about how we got through it because our parents did not live through this.
No.
You know, our parents lived through the Depression.
Well, to dispute something that Paul said, this is one story that hasn't been told.
Well, that is true. Mm-hmm. That is true. And I'm sure there will be plenty of musicals about this time.
I'm already hearing the ideas floating around and everything.
Yes, of course. We're staging will be social distancing, even though when we're past that.
Now, one thing, we've got an exclusive today because you have a new CD that's coming out it's the beginning of a new project that you're working on that's launching on Tuesday.
Yes.
And with your kind permission, I would like to share a snippet, if I may.
Sure.
And then we'll talk about this on the other side. So of enjoy course. This is your latest work.
Yes.
At the times when you're more afraid, that is the moment when dreams are made. They've dressed you and I. When the legend's over, and we have just begun, we can look to each other.
Just amazing.
Thank you.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Wow. So beautiful. I mean, how long does it take you to write a song such as this? It's
well,
so
the thing is, this project called Review is a collection of my hits. And so this song was written a very long time ago by Carole Sager and I. And the thing about these songs is they have grown with me. They've mm-hmm. never gone out of fashion, thank God. And that was not our intention at all. We were writing together every day, and that's what we were doing. But when this first came out in, I think, 78, you know, the women's movement was still sort of fresh. The AIDS crisis had not quite shown up yet. But it has found its moment. And the thing about the production of this is I recorded this down at Citrus College, which is about 50 miles and 50 minutes southeast of where I live in Los Angeles, in Glendora, California. It's a community college, but they have an absolutely spectacular music department.
And you recorded there prior.
And studio. Yes. And I recorded this in their studio. And what you were hearing are the Citrus singers. These are all students. And all the musicians are students. And I composed all of the background parts, and it was just it was such a blessing to revisit all of this and have it infused with such new energy in this moment. So the video will come out on Tuesday. That's the whole song.
Yeah. I wasn't allowed to show the full video today.
No.
It was just a teaser, but we got it first, didn't we?
Yes, you did. Yes, you did.
Thank you so much. I understand that you're going to be releasing a new song each month.
Correct.
As we go through this.
Correct.
When did you come up with the idea for that? I think it's ingenious.
Well, I think, you know, my friend Dave Koz is doing that with his new project, Colors of Rainbow. And I just figured that is, as we say, keeps the narrative going. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And at the end of it, and I have two songs that I hadn't gotten to, and we're trying to figure out how to do those two songs. But I just think that it gives you time to absorb the song, live with the video, see if it resonates. It'll be on all kinds of platforms where you can download it. And I hope you do. And then at the end, you know, there will be this new album called View.
Yeah.
And the whole point of it is to you know, I've grown into these songs. These have become monologues for me. And as you grow into something, though the basic structure and the composition holds, thank goodness, you know, the harmonics get tweaked, or, you know, there are no fades on this album. Not one. This is a fade-free zone. We're so 70s. I just love the way you do it on stage. It comes to an end and people go nuts. Mm-hmm. I wanted to have that effect on these songs.
When and how did the fade come into being? Do you remember?
Well, I don't know how it came into being. I mean, it was always on records as long as I am, maybe in the 50s. I think it had to do with having enough tagline to go into the news or to go into an advertisement or to go into something to eat up a little time. But it's you know, it's fine. It's just not interesting.
Now, have you done any master classes or anything online, or have you thought about doing that to reach beyond these students that you work with at Citrus College?
I haven't. Everybody is so scattered, and you know, my beautiful colleagues at Citrus, they are scrambling to figure out how to do college for their students, and it's just heartbreaking. Everybody is struggling. Yeah.
Now, are they currently going to school, or
I don't believe so.
So everything is happening virtually right now.
Yep. Yep. And it's, you know, and it's hard. It's hard to go into, you know, my daughter just received her MBA. She did it completely online while she's working for a company. And so it's just making the world work for you. Really wild.
Now, the last time that I saw you in concert in New Jersey, you were doing Here's to the Boys.
The Fellas.
And it was such an incredible concert. I know that it was a follow-up to the ladies. When did you decide to do, you know, both of those? And it's just incredible. Both CDs are incredible. And
Tribute was done for my love. You know, I'm here standing on the shoulders of real greatness, you know, great artists that I grew up with listening to because my parents loved this music too, particularly my mom. Mm-hmm. And so when I had the opportunity, I wanted to pay tribute to these great women because to me, Ella Fitzgerald and Judy Garland are my psychic musical mm-hmm. godmothers, you know. And but there were certainly many others, and I got a chance to have all of those songs orchestrated by the late great Peter Matz. Mm. And that was remarkable working with him as well. And then I had always wanted to finish that concept with the fellas, but nobody was interested. And, you know, and so I just had to wait. And then when I became artist in residence at Citrus College, Bob Slack, who was the dean of the music department at one point, came to me and he said, is there some project you can think of that can incorporate our players? I said, funny you should ask. And that's how the fellas came to be. And I had wonderful orchestrators doing different charts, Terry Wallman, David Catalan, Doug Walter, just beautiful, Peter Hume. So that was a joy. And then I got a chance to do it in performance. You know, it was great fun.
That's wonderful. Now, believe it or not, we are moving towards the end of our program. And before we get there, however, I always like to end every show that I do by telling everyone to go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. Mm-hmm. Go to your Facebook friends page, go to the sixth name that pops up and give them a phone call today. Not an email.
Very good.
Pick up the phone, call that person and say, I just want you to know I'm thinking of you. And Melissa and Richard told me I should call you.
Yes, indeed. And, people have been doing that. Yes, that is the truth. This is the moment to stay in touch with people or be reminded of people that you haven't stayed in touch with.
And then on Tuesday, when this drops, I want you to share that with your six friends so that we get the music out to everybody.
Yes, please.
I want to ask you, is there anything that you have not done in your career that you really say that's still on my bucket list?
Oh, tons. But you know, I do it as it comes, and we'll see.
And do you have any type of structure in your day-to-day life with everything that's going on right now?
You know, one thing I have learned is to let each day unfold. You know, since I'm putting the final touches on the video, there's lots of details and there are emails going back and forth between my videographer and Sue Holder, as you know, mm-hmm. and myself. And so that is work that is getting done. Do I sit at the piano every day? No, I don't. Some days I just read. Some days I walk. Some days I swim. It's very hot out here. And
I think you told me it's 106 today.
Right now it is. It's probably more like 110 right now.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow.
September is always a blistering month. So anyway, but all is interesting. It's just such an interesting time. And thank you for creating and keeping this platform going. I think it's really interesting and important to remind people that everybody's worthy and on a journey. And
thank you. I appreciate that. I wanted to ask, and I hope I'm not putting you on the spot. I was going to ask for one of my favorite songs, but I'm going to let you choose.
No. What is one of your favorite songs? I wonder if I can play it.
Don't Cry Out Loud is my favorite song that you wrote.
Okay. All right. Well, I didn't write Don't Cry Out Loud. Don't
yes,
Cry Out Loud.
I know that.
By Carole Sager and the great Peter Allen. But, yes. But oh, my goodness. What happened to my piano? Hold on. One moment. Oh, I think, there you go. Well, here we go. Baby cried the day the circus came to town, 'cause she didn't want parades just passing by her. So she painted on a smile, took up with some clown, as she danced without a net upon the wire.
a lot about her, 'cause you see, baby is an awful lot like me. Don't cry out loud, just keep it inside. Learn how to hide your feelings. Fly high and proud, and if you should fall, remember you almost had it all. You almost had it all. Baby saw that when they pulled that big top down, they left behind her dreams among the litter, and that different kind of love she thought she'd found, there was nothing left but sawdust and some glitter. But baby can't be broken, 'cause you see, she had the finest teacher, that was me. And I told her, don't cry out loud, just keep it inside. Learn how to hide your feelings. Fly high and proud, and if you should fall, remember you almost had it all. You almost had it all. You almost had it all.
Melissa, now I do have it all. You are absolutely the best. I love you so much. And I do want to give a huge shout out to Susan Holder. You're lucky to have her in your life.
Amen. Thank you.
She is a true blessing. And I thank her for arranging this. You made my Sunday and my week. I can get through the rest of this year. Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. Thank you so much.
Have
Be well.
Have a wonderful afternoon. And thank you all for tuning in. And I am serious. Please, please, please reach out to your sixth friend today. Love you, Melissa.
Love you, honey. Be well. Thank you.